invited to perform for the royal families of Japan and Thailand. If you're invited by French designer Pierre Cardin to choreograph on the famous Bolshoi ballerina, prima ballerina Maya Plisetskaya, you know you're something special. Well, I think before India even acknowledged its amazingly brilliant son, the world had already seen what Astad Debu could do, the magic that he could create. Deeply introspective, a favorite, a go-to favorite for international collaborators. His signature, his presence, his artistry, his thought, his poetics was everywhere. I want to invite the director of the INCO Cultural Center, the Indo-Korean Cultural Center here in Chennai, Rati Jaffer, to speak to us, because the wonderful collaboration, Same, Same, But Different, was the last performance and large intercultural collaboration that Astad undertook. It was a magical performance on the Kalakshetra Auditorium. And I was smiling to myself because here was an auditorium created by a dreamer in her time, Rukmini Devi, who came from ballet and created this iconic institution. And here was another dreamer, a lone traveler, Astad Debu, on that stage. And I was convinced that Atte Rukmini Devi was smiling. I was convinced that she completely approved of what was happening that February evening in 2020. So I want to welcome Rati to our Instagram Live.
Okay, lovely, lovely. First of all, Anita, thank you for this brilliant initiative. I think it's the most wonderful way to pay tribute to a wonderful human being whom all of us have had the good opportunity to have met and engaged with. So first of all, thank you to you and to your team for pulling this together. I'm very honored to be invited to join this lovely panel of friends and family and collaborators to talk about Astad. So I'm going to cut straight to your question of the collaboration itself. But yes, I must backtrack a bit to say that the first collaboration was a theater, music and dance one, which was Hamlet Avatar. And this was in 2014-15. And Astad was so happy to be invited because there he was as Othello's, as Hamlet's father, the ghost. And he was also doubling up as a jester. And he was bringing both his dance aesthetics and his wonderful feel of the stage and his enormous experience, which I think the young artist really drew from and drew energy from. And all, mind you, with his typical rigor, but at the same time, so much compassion. So he was able to cut through the stuff that didn't work, but very compassionately to tell him that maybe you should try something a little different. And he was laughing off the stage because he said, this is me now in a new avatar. It's Hamlet avatar, but new avatar as an actor. I'm here as an actor now, and I have to sort of remind myself that that's my position on stage. Now, cut to 1920, and the one you saw at Kalakshetra, Same, Same, But Different. There, he was there very much as a dancer who was providing a very still, almost Zen-like counterpoint to the percussion and all the kind of frenzy of the musicians as they built up the tempo. So very often he would talk about these two contrasts and how much he enjoyed both in different ways. And I think for us, we were extremely privileged to work with somebody who has worked across the world, as you mentioned. He's worked with some of the best and well-known companies. And for him to have so graciously accepted what was a sort of a early days yet collaboration, but with a lot of positive energy there, and to lift it to the heights that he did. So I think we were indeed privileged to work with somebody of his caliber, but more important, of somebody who had that humanity and that humaneness, if you like, empathy to reach out and say, yes, some of you may be very new to the stage. I might be an old hand at this, but we are all equal and we can all share and we can all learn from each other. So that was a tremendously fruitful experience, a tremendously rigorous process, because the workshops were both in Korea and in India. There were, it was not without its sort of disagreements and fights, because I think this is all part of the creative process, but done in the most civil sort of way, to say, even if an inch of his space was taken, he would say, no, I'm sorry, I don't agree. Or you've cut back on something else. And then the artistic director and Astad would have this chat just to agree. And it would be the most beautiful thing ever when that happened on stage. So Kalakshetra and Same Same was very, very special, because I think we were looking at what are the similarities between Korean and Indian artistic traditions, performance traditions? What are the differences, and how do we find that magical shared space? And how does that happen without compromising on either side? So Anita, long answer to your question.
Yeah, but my question to you, Rati, as you know, you're the enabler, you're the funder, you dream a project, you have to bring Korean and Indian traditions together. Why did you think of Astad?
Good question.
Was it just the one choice?
Yeah, I think it was almost immediate. We had a list, but Astad came in, I think, because at that point in his career as well, given his long oeuvre and how he sort of transitioned to a much more still, quiet, inward-looking, introspective sort of performer, who also related very much to the space around him. So since the whole project, both projects in fact, derived out of that space object artist kind of triangle that we were looking at, I think Astad pretty quickly was an almost automatic choice. And the second project, because we having worked with him in the first, I think it gave us a little leeway to know about his work pattern and what he brought to the entire collaboration. So I keep wondering if we had done this a couple of years earlier, if he were at a different stage in his career, I don't know whether it would have then been quite so automatic a choice. So I think that's how it happened. But we did have very long discussions about how he could, and I think always all of what has been his the high point in all of his performances, the role of costumes, the stillness, which is counterpointing movement and sort of other stuff that's happening on stage, this ability to bring that extreme professional rigor to the whole residency. We had long residencies in both India and Korea before we put this together. So I think all of those things were long debated, first with me and Dastad. We used to sit around for a long while, actually, and then continue on mail and phone. But then I think when the teams came together with the artistic director, so Hyung-Taek Lim, who was the director of Hamlet, did come to Astad's performance during one of the Margari seasons. We invited him at the beginning. He also saw Parvati Baul, and he saw a couple of others, and all of, and then he chose Astad Parvati as a kind of counterbalance, as it were. And the second time again, we invited Joo Hong Kim to come and see him in performance, quite separate from any decision making, just watch him in his own space and see whether this works. So I think the process itself was quite long, but once we had agreed and decided, it was 2 to 3 short weeks of residencies in either country, and over a period of a year and a half, it sort of developed. And then we presented in Korea, in Seoul, at the Seoul Performing Arts Festival. We was with in India at the Royal Opera House in Mumbai, in Kalakshetra, and also Jagriti in Bangalore. So I think that was extremely exciting for all of us. Astad was almost like a child, where when he was like sort of, you know, quickly checking to see where this would go. And he did all his bit to promote. You know, he's amazing at promoting his shows, and he was sending it all out to, you know, friends and family. And in 2020, we were discussing, my gosh, we just skin of our teeth, we managed before the lockdown to finish this project. How would it have been if we were to present it during the lockdown on a virtual platform? And he said, oh, no, I need the stage, and I need the space, and I need the people out there. So I'm really glad it happened before the lockdown. In fact, soon after that, we went into lockdown. So we just managed to put that out there.
I heard that he was so emotional, because he had never performed at the Royal Opera House.
Can you imagine? That was his first time. That was his first time,
his
and
first
unfortunately,
performance in his own hometown of Bombay.
Absolutely, but at the end of it, Asad Lalji, whom he kindly introduced me to and was very gracious at putting this whole thing together, actually mentioned that. And they said, I don't know why we've waited so long to have you on the stage. And Asad was sort of just laughing. And he said, well, you didn't invite me before this. And, you know, I'm here now kind of thing. I don't think it was about invitation. I think it just didn't happen because of his, he was also in that last few years traveling a lot and doing a lot of collaborations abroad. So I think in the scheme of things, it just didn't happen. So it was quite fortuitous that it happened there in his hometown on that stage. And we had a fantastic audience that night. Everybody just lapped it up. And there were lots of musicians and performers and dancers, writers in the audience. I think that made a huge difference as well.
Yeah. But Rati, when in the process, when you observed him, he was the elder, right? He's 70. He was the elder in the group. Did you find that the Korean team, and of course the Indian team, they who doesn't know Asad? Were they sort of, did you feel that they were learning from him, absorbing something from him? Was there that sense that they were in the presence of a master?
Yes. Now, this was something that had to be handled very carefully on either side. Because although Hyungtaek, the Hamlet Avatar director, and Joo Hong Kim are very well known in their own spheres, have performed and collaborated all over the world, they were very aware that we were bringing in a maestro, we're bringing in somebody with an enormous track record. And they kind of, I think the first meeting was interesting for me because I was kind of observing the energies in the room and what was really happening. And I remember telling Asad before we went into the room that, you know, all of them are in awe of you. So we've got to, you know, keep this, set this balance in a way in which it's a healthy interaction. Otherwise they'll hold back or they will only tell me and it won't be smooth at all. But it was quite, and I think that was the feeling at the beginning. When he went in there, everybody was silent and they were all bowing to him and they were all sort of, you know, giving him the best seat in the room kind of thing. But I think Asad so graciously broke that and very easily sort of told the director, okay, you tell me, you're in charge here and I will go with it. But slowly as the process went on, you could clearly see he was bringing a lot of what he already had and he was tremendous in sharing that so graciously to sort of say, okay, you've told me to do so and so, but how about I do it this way? And he would show something else, which then they would say, oh, wow, this fits in greatly. I mean, this is amazing. But as a gesture, for instance, I think he was doing that for the first time. So he allowed himself to be led there. He said, okay, I'm not the actor. I can come in to do, but the Othello, the ghost scenes where he did his famous twirl and he came in, you know, quite dramatically on stage. He brought us something extra to it in the same but different, exactly so. You had the musicians all playing. He didn't interfere with their process. And I think they pretty much allowed him to sort of read into their music and then come up, improvise. And he did say that he might improvise. And the musician said, okay, we'll watch out if you're doing 20 twirls, 60 twirls. We'll just go with it. Give us a little sign to tell us, keep going. You know, so those things were fantastic. And therefore, I think the younger artists all felt extremely privileged to perform with him, but they also learned a lot from him. And I think it was that rigor that they all admired. You know, whenever we have anything, he would be there bang on time. He would stay there till the very end. And then end of it, when we would all go out for a drink or hearty, he was always there. He was part of the team. And for many, he was like this father figure, and they would tease him, you know, to that in good jest, and he would take it that way. And I think that sort of lightened the mood, even with Parvati when she came in. I think as two artists who have two tremendously different vocabularies, very different styles of working, it would be wrong to say that it just went through seamlessly. Of course not. There were moments and where there were those, and I call those creative clashes, which I think are important. They're really important for people to be able to do. But to allow, I think our job was to allow for that space and make everybody feel involved and engaged so that they could all contribute and bring value to the table. So I'm so glad that this happened. I've known Asad from my British Council days, you know, years ago, but I've only known him as a performer, as somebody in the audience who enjoyed his work and went up and spoke to him about it. But that was it. These last few years have been, I think, you know, an opportunity to understand more angles than one, understand the man and appreciate the genius. and really appreciate and celebrate this. He had this tremendous way with people, and you became, once you became his friend, you were like sort of friend for life. So he would send you stuff on WhatsApp, even like right up to the last days. He would be sending his old photographs, beautiful costumes. In fact, the project that unfortunately hadn't got done because we had only started talking about it last year was a sort of interactive exhibition come performance space with his costumes and with his photographs and with him performing in that space. So I'm hoping, Anita, and I'm putting it out there, we're still okay with taking this project. Unfortunately, we won't have Astad dancing in that space, but maybe his students, maybe somebody who is able to sort of relate to his oeuvre. This is something for the future, and we definitely want to take it forward.
Okay, all right, you put it out there, the intention is out there.
Yeah.
And people are listening and watching, let's see what happens. But thank you so much, Rati, for bringing us this collaboration and for me and many others being able to see Astad, his last performance, or his, almost his last performance, you know, before he left us. So, and like, once again, wishing him a very happy birthday, and thank you.
Happy birthday, Astad. I know you're enjoying with whoever, your friends who are up there with you. I'm sure you are, and all of us here have been thinking of you through the day. I'm so glad you chose his birthday, because I think that's the best way to celebrate a life that has been lived to the fullest and a life that has been generously shared. So I think this is such a self-made man, which I'm always so amazed with the stories of how he trekked across, what he did, what he achieved. And therefore, when he found some small little difficult thing to do, he would always laugh it off and say, it's not a big deal, we'll do it, you know? So it was... part of this journey in whatever small way. And so nice to link with all of you this evening to celebrate Astad Debu. Thank you, Anita, for this wonderful initiative.
Thank you, Rati.
And
thank you. Bye.
We'll keep in touch. Bye. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye.